Although integration was beginning to be introduced to America and popular culture in the late 50s and early 60s, the black communities were still faced with many challenges. Baltimore was still segregated, and Pennsylvania Avenue was starting to change. Due to the Brown versus Board ruling, many of the great role models and teachers of the segregated neighborhoods were transferred out of their schools and into white schools.
Many people don't fully understand the impact that Brown v. Board in 1954 had on their lives. In essence, the better teachers were taken from the segregated schools. The better students were now taken from the segregated schools and placed in white schools as minorities. And you began to see the stripping of the sustainable black community.
In the 1960s, crime started to rise around the avenue. Despite the rise of crime and the loss of important community members, the scene on the avenue prevailed and continued to bring in famous musicians to Baltimore. New clubs were still opening up, all standing as a launchpad for local area musicians trying to enter the national spotlight.
So the avenue was no longer what it was in the 40s and 50s. There were clubs still there. The Red Fox was still there. That's how I met Ethel. Henry Baker had come off the road and had a little club in that same block called Peyton Place. The music is one of the things I think that broke down the segregated Baltimore. There were still people, white folks in particular, who would make an effort to come to listen to black music because they heard something in it that they responded to. And a lot of times their parents didn't like it or their teachers didn't like it, but they still came.
As we say, America, you're black, you better do something and you have to be three times as good. And it's true. You do have to excel in whatever you do because of your color, and that's a shame.
Ethel Innes started playing music professionally while still in high school in Baltimore. She eventually released her first solo album, Lullabies for Losers, in 1955.
But Ethel became a singer by accident. You know, she didn't train for it, she wasn't looking for it. She happened to be a piano player in a band, and they happened to ask for a song, and then when the response came out, she said, I can do this.
Yeah, so I can hang up my shingle as a singer now.
So she.
Do I get paid doubly? No.
She played, she developed from that band to playing piano with a bass player, a duo. And then at the Red Fox in the 50s, she played with vibraphonists and, you know, drummers, small groups, but she was playing piano and singing. It wasn't until the 60s that she moved away from the piano. Ethel was called a jazz singer, but never felt that she was.
I do not consider myself a jazz singer. Now, I guess the reason why they tagged that on to me, when I was in New York, I was given, you know, a song to sing, and I, you know, was singing a song, and I decided to, you know, change it just a little bit. The notes I chose, you know, were part of the scale, so, you know, no problem with that. It fits. But they said, I guess they said, okay, she's a jazz singer, you know, if you don't sing it straight down like it's written. I guess that's what I was talking about, you know, people say jazz, you got the form, but when you add your feelings and what you put on top of it, that's your freedom. No, that's jazz.
Breaking the laws in Maryland, Ethel would travel with Earl Arnett outside the Maryland border to get married in 1967. On a similar path, but many years earlier, another Baltimore musician was becoming very well known for his amazing musical skills, and he also looked to transcend the boundaries of racism. Mickey Fields, a Baltimore saxophone legend, would also have to travel out of the state to get married to the love of his life.
Segregation was here. He never came to my house. He never came to my, he didn't come to my mother's house. I would meet him and then we would, you know, go out from there. But I was familiar. He would take me to Pennsylvania Avenue, to the Royal Theater, and I saw great shows that I never would have seen in the white places. They loved Mickey. He was young. He was only 19, and it was just a different time, a great time.
Every one of the 11 children in the Fields family has some musical talents, which they inherited from their father, who played the piano and the organ in church.
He never heard me play saxophone. I wish he was still living to hear me play, you know, but he'd be proud right now if he heard me. But he died when I was around 14, yeah, about 14 or 15, you know. And about a year after he died, that's when I first switched to saxophone, you know. But I wish he could hear me play.
You know, play just about anything and could play it well and really had that, the blues, which is the feel. You know, it's the human element, it's the cry, you know.
And Mickey was one of those people that everybody kind of knew from coming into town. They knew about Mickey Fields.
He'd talk with you and just try to encourage you to not give up, because this music is not easy for us, and it really wasn't easy for them, because they were living in the times of oppression, of economic frustration, living in communities where there was infiltration of the ills of society, where drugs really destroyed a lot of communities. Integration and segregation, how they both worked, how they helped, and how they destroyed some communities.
So we're talking about 50s would be the prime, and 60s for Mickey. And Ethel's brother Andy is a saxophone player, and he and Mickey were tight buddies.
Oh yeah.
And when they played, students from Towson and other places in the area would come to listen, mm-hmm. because both of them had great ears. They weren't playing off of scores, they were playing just from what they heard and felt.
From each other.
And going back and forth. And they got a lot of interesting things going on with the two horns. But see, that was the key thing with a lot of music in clubs in particular. You know, it wasn't written down. So there were always people like that, you know, players that moved in these musical circles. And Baltimore was a place where you could find them. And that's how Andy happened to be found by Ray Charles.
Andy Ennis left Baltimore to tour with Ray Charles, but Mickey stayed home. Despite being offered chances to tour with countless famous musicians time and time again, Mickey stayed in Baltimore to be closer to his family and to be close to the clubs on the avenue.
That road thing with musicians is something else.
Yeah,
you know?
It seems to be a hard life.
It is hard, and it takes its toll, and that's why some musicians just decided to stay home, you know, and have families and you know, have another kind of life.
Baltimore had the privilege of keeping Mickey Fields close at home, and while Ethel Ennis was touring all over the world, she would always keep coming back too. Even Cab, UB, and Ellis Larkins would frequently visit Baltimore to perform, despite living in different cities and regularly touring the world. One musician that would choose to stay in Baltimore instead of touring was Whit Williams. He moved to Baltimore from North Carolina in 1954 to attend Morgan State College. He would end up staying in Baltimore after college, starting a family and teaching countless young musicians in the city while performing at the Royal Theater and other venues.
He actually was among the African-American musicians in Baltimore, kind of a trailblazer, because especially with like playing shows and in pit orchestras, because that work like did not exist for African-Americans. And Roy McCoy, who I talked about earlier, and my father were two of the first African-American musicians that started to be called by the white union, because, you know, in those days, there used to, and a lot of people don't know this, there used to be an African-American union and a white union. They were separate. Like, for instance, the Baltimore local, I think, is 40-543. The 40 is the white union. The 543 was the black union. And I remember as a child, hanging out with my father during the summer when he was not teaching, and we'd go to the black union.
In the 1960s, while Ethel Ennis is performing on national television, her brother Andy is jamming out with Mickey Fields, and Whit Williams is transcending race of the segregated local Baltimore Musicians Union. Ideas like success, integration, and peace are almost commonplace. Young black leaders were rising up all around America. In 1964, following Kennedy's dream of a truly equal society, and while working with some of America's most important black leaders, LBJ signs into law the Civil Rights Act, outlawing discrimination based on race, color, skin, religion, sex, or national origin, essentially ending the Jim Crow era and segregation in the U.S.
The Great Society rests on abundance and liberty for all. It demands an end to poverty and racial injustice, to which we're totally committed in our time. But that is just the beginning. The Great Society is a place where every child can find knowledge to enrich his mind and to enlarge his talent. It is a place where leisure is a welcome chance to build and reflect, not a feared cause of boredom and restlessness. It is a place where the city of man serves not only the needs of the body and the demands of commerce, but the desire for beauty and the hunger for community.
In the 1950s and early 60s, Pennsylvania Avenue was probably at its most exciting point in history. The national mood was focused around change, and the effects of that could be seen in Baltimore. It seemed as though there were more things to do on the avenue than ever. You could go see a Hollywood film in the region, or go to Mom's on the Avenue to eat. The massive selection of clubs gave an amazing variety of live national and local musical acts to pick from.
It was called the Avenue. We never said Pennsylvania music. Well, we're going down the Avenue tonight, you know, and so Fridays and Saturdays, that's what you did. You just group, you know, your friends and just walk down the Avenue. You'd see people who you knew in school because being segregated, we had, Baltimore had two black high schools on the west side and one on the east side. The east side, of course, was Dunbar. West side was George Washington Carver Vocational and Frederick Douglass. But we would go down to the avenue and just walk down. The clubs were open. You'd hear the music. You know, the Royal Theater was popping. You know, you'd see the stage shows. I mean, very, very exciting time.
One of my all-time favorites is the Sphinx Club. Was really, it's a documentary in its own right. It's a book. It's a TV show. It's a place that if you think of modern-day Cheers, where everybody knows your name, that was the old Sphinx Club. You could see Jackie Robinson up in there, you could see Little Willie Adams, you could see the first black attorney general for Baltimore, city solicitor George L. Russell. It was a place to be. It was a private members-only club. They had a membership card, which we were fortunate to have some of in the archives, but overall, if you knocked on the door and the people knew you, you could come in. They had softball teams and they had bowling. It was an extended family. Yeah, there were quite a bit of elbow benders in there, but it was a place that you felt like you belonged and you were with like-minded people. On any given evening, you could be hanging out in there with doctors, lawyers, educators, athletes.
There's a lot of places that were so prominent and a part of that legacy that is Baltimore and Pennsylvania Avenue as well.
The musicians used to just travel the avenue with their instruments, you know, just joining in with the music, playing and jamming.
You could still find a little club where you could listen to music and sometimes be inspired by something you'd never heard before. So that was just ebbing when I arrived, but it was still there. There was still some places farther down on the avenue, clubs that were open. One of the big things that stopped all that were the riots of 68.
We have taken the following steps to restore law and order in our state, and you may be sure that the situation is under control and under constant vigilance of state and local authorities. We have proclaimed a state of emergency in Baltimore City and Baltimore County. A curfew has been imposed in Baltimore City from 4 p.m. to 6 a.m., and I have requested the business community to do the same. Executive orders have been issued prohibiting the sale of alcoholic beverages, firearms, ammunition, flammable materials, and liquids in Baltimore City and Baltimore County. Every available unit of the Maryland National Guard has been fully mobilized and deployed within the city. In addition, at 6:11 this evening, I requested federal reinforcements to to further secure the city. Attorney General Ramsey Clark agreed to immediately dispatch the troops. They should now be taking positions in the critical areas. These steps have been taken to control violence, save lives and property, and to bring about a swift restoration of order. I want to commend the overwhelming majority of our citizens, white and black, who have remained calm in these hours of crisis. I ask you to continue this example, to remain at home and obey the curfew. I urge all parents to exercise vigilance over their children. In the affected area, much of the lawlessness to date has been caused by unruly and unsupervised youths.
We feel now that we must sit down and we must prepare ourselves so that we can get a job done, because we do not want a recurrence of what happened in the city of Baltimore last week. And we feel that in order to eliminate or to wipe out the type of thing that happened, we must respond to the people. We cannot respond to the people until we know what their problems are. To know their problems, we must go into the streets.
Baltimoreans, white and Negro alike, must rededicate themselves sincerely, to a policy and a behavior of nonviolence, positive nonviolence. It means that each one of us must use real personal restraint to be the kind of an American that Dr. King wanted us all to be. I think, too, the Negro community expects, more than ever now, the recommendations of the Koenig Commission on Civil Disorders, the recommendations of that report, to be implemented actively. Businessmen must hire. The city government, must take Negroes into all kinds of representational spots. Churches must respond to their moral dictates. In short, everybody must be an American. I think this is the answer to Dr. King's death.
We haven't rebuilt. Some of those depressed areas never came back to life after the devastation that we did to our own community.
A street which has been rejected by a large segment of society, but has not rejected itself. Some call it Pensy, some Death Valley, some the Mecca. Its formal title is Pennsylvania Avenue, Baltimore, a 2.5-mile ribbon of life, light, and depression, stretching from the core of Baltimore City northwest to Druid Hill Park. Before World War II, Pennsylvania Avenue was the visible hub of Negro life and activity in Baltimore, because downtown was more or less off limits to Negroes. Pennsylvania Avenue became the bustling center of the black man's working life and leisure hours. After the war, however, much of the Negro middle class moved out of the area, and businessmen along the avenue, most of them white, began to complain of a decline in sales. South of North Avenue, stores closed. Theaters became movie houses, and many jazz clubs either shut their doors or became bars with jukeboxes instead of live bands. Residences along Pennsylvania Avenue became the exclusive home of poor Negroes with incomes averaging $3,750 for a family of five. Between 1950 and 1960, the area's population declined by 20%. More and more, the word slum was used to describe what was once a reasonable, healthy community. Few dared to venture into the area at night. So bad was Pensy's reputation as a breeding ground for crime, prostitution, and drug addiction.
As black people are beginning to get together, that means that we are beginning to identify with things that we have been led to reject. And one of the things that we've rejected has been, of course, ourselves. Another thing has been, for instance, the turf that we live on. And we like to think in Baltimore very much of something that is central to the turf that we live in. And we feel that Pennsylvania Avenue sort of symbolizes this. We rejected it before, we accept it now. And you can see a renewed dedication and commitment to this turf. You can see it in the way people behave. You can see it in the way the men walk straight, with the chins up, the heads up, that we are not afraid of ourselves, we're not ashamed of ourselves, we're identifying with our own African roots, we're in Africa, and in Baltimore, we're identifying with our own roots, which were rooted west and east of Pennsylvania Avenue, which we like to call Soulsville.
Part of the problem of equal and fair employment is still another problem that goes far deeper. Equal and fair education.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible.
When the kid makes the pledge, part of his pledge is to one nation, indivisible. But we are divided, in fact. And how can we say to black kids in a black school that is dilapidated, deteriorated, and segregated that he's living in one nation, indivisible? Soul is a lot of emotions and experiences that have been based on something, a history that people have shared in common. It means struggling. It means sacrifice. When John Coltrane played, he said a black man could feel that he was communicating the black man's experience in America from New Orleans on up to right now. Now that's so. That is not just a melody written by the man, but it's an expression of a people, their struggle, their beauty, their survival in a foreign land, but in a land where a whole new value system has been produced. And if you want to know the black mood today, all you have to do is be able to listen and to feel with these great artists who had the guts to break away from the myths and the hypocrisies of America, from its commercialism, who had the strength to stay away and express themselves culturally, to express themselves artistically.